By December 1977, the Yorkshire Ripper's tally of killings, four in that year alone, was causing Leeds and Bradford prostitutes to start taking their own precautions against this deadly predator. He himself realized that he would have to put on a reassuring act when, on December the 14th, he watched plump and pleasant Marilyn Moore turn down a punter who looked dodgy to her. This was in Spencer Place, the tree-lined Victorian avenue that is the centre of street prostitution in Leeds's Chapel Town. Thinking quickly, the would-be murderer noted that she'd marked him as a cruiser, swung his car out of Spencer Place to Franklin Place and Louis Street, where he jumped out and shouted, "Bye now, see you later. Take care," at the house beside him, as though he'd just put down a passenger. Just as he'd hoped, Marilyn came round the corner looking for him and saw this little pantomime. He was a dark, stocky man, aged about 30, with black hair and a beard. He was wearing a yellow shirt and jeans under a navy anorak. As she walked purposefully past him, he said, "Are you doing business?" "Yes," she said. "£5?" he asked. Marilyn acquiesced and got into the car, the more completely reassured as he introduced himself as Dave and talked about two girls on the game called Hillary and Gloria. Marilyn knew two girls by those names. She was also satisfied by his story that he'd been waving goodbye to his girlfriend in Leopold Street and that she was ill. Dave said he knew a good, quiet place and drove her to Scott Hall Road. There he suggested that they do it in the back of the car. Marilyn agreed and got out, only to find the back door locked. Dave came round behind her, saying he would open it. Fortunately, he slipped as he struck her, and his first blow glanced off her head. Marilyn screamed and went on screaming as he struck her again, and she fell at his feet, grasping his jeans. A third blow failed to silence her, and the noise disturbed a dog, which started barking. At the same time, the murderer saw two people approaching at about 40 yards distance. Marilyn heard him run to the driving door, slam it, and race the engine to get away quickly. The wheels spun furiously on the wet road as he made his racing start. This unsuccessful assault gave two important clues. Marilyn's description of her assailant was excellent, and the photo fit prepared with her approval would turn out to be a pretty good likeness. This should have been put together with Marcella Claxton's earlier account of the man who'd attacked her on the soldiers' field to ensure at the very least some completely wrong avenues of investigation were explored sparingly. Better still, the wheel marks left by the car proved identical with those left in the other soldiers' field crime, the murder of Irene Richardson in February. Mercifully, Marilyn Moore had survived, but there could be no doubt that one and the same man was attacking prostitutes in Leeds, and if he could be traced before he disposed of the half-worn cross-ply India tyres on his car, he could be charged. But the heat was really on in Leeds. Marked and unmarked police cars patrolled the small red light area around Spencer Place in unprecedented numbers. Women police constables were sent out in plain clothes to pretend they were on the game and take the numbers of punters who approached them. Others were placed in unmarked cars at the roadside with plain clothes men, and the couples would lock themselves into a tight clinch while actually peering over each other's shoulders to observe the action at the curbsides and memorize the car numbers. The girls on the game were well aware of what was going on, but in spite of the obvious risk to themselves, they were above all delighted that there would be no arrests or prosecutions for soliciting, while the CID was preoccupied with the business of trying to identify one lethal punter. The Ripper apparently realized that Leeds was patrolled too heavily for safety. He shifted away and back to Bradford, enjoying the good fortune that his first victim there in 1978 was not discovered for 3 months. Yvonne Pearson was usually a more upmarket performer than the run-of-the-mill Yorkshire street girl. Her hair was expensively blonded and set, though the trendy pudding-basin cut and sullen expression frozen in her police mugshot make it hard to see why she was always described as attractive. No doubt she really was when her face was animated. Her clientele was normally drawn from the wealthy business community, and though she was a Yorkshire girl, she'd travelled to big cities across the country finding work. Recently, she'd been in London. But there, a friend of hers working out of a flat in Bayswater had been murdered on the job. Yvonne had also been an occasional drinking companion of Tina Atkinson, the Bradford victim of the Ripper, who had worked from her bed-sitting room and been killed in her own bed. These two sad experiences led Yvonne to make a fatal decision. She decided to give up working from a flat for the time being and take punters from the street to pieces of waste land. The open-air trade might be cheaper and nastier, but it did give a chance to run away. On Saturday the 28th of January, the Ripper's father moved from Bradford to Bingley. Yes, even atrocious murderers can have perfectly normal families with whom they behave like perfectly normal people. The Ripper and his brother spent the afternoon and early evening helping move the old man's things. Then the Ripper, who had a wife to go home to, left. As he drove through Bradford, cruising the Lum Lane red light district which he knew so well, a van backed sharply out of a side turning in front of him. He hit the brakes and came to a stop, and as he did so, a good-looking blonde wearing black sweater and slacks, whom he had not noticed on the pavement, tapped on his window. He rolled it down and asked, "Where did you spring from so suddenly?"
"Just good timing," Yvonne Pearson replied cheerfully. "You can put it down to fate."
Yes, she was doing business. £5 for a good time, £10 for more than a good time. How much could he afford? "Not £10, he replied. He was always close with his money. It didn't stop her accepting him as a client. She directed him to a piece of waste ground at the back of a mill, the very mill, in fact, where his father worked. As she stepped out of the car, he pulled a hammer from under his seat and smashed her over the head. Usually he carried a ball-peen hammer of normal size with a rounded end, but this time he was using an enormous lump hammer used for walling. The blow was shattering, but it didn't kill her outright, and she fell to the ground moaning. At that point, another car drove onto the waste ground and parked alongside the murderer's vehicle. To silence his victim, he reached quickly over to a ripped and abandoned sofa that was lying in the yard, pulled out some horsehair stuffing and thrust it into her mouth. Then he crouched over her, holding her nose to keep her quiet all the while Yvonne's colleague was busy with her client. From time to time he relaxed his grip to hear if Yvonne was still audibly alive. She was, and it was not until the business in the next car was finished that he could batter her to death. Then, as was his custom, he pulled her sweater and bra up above her breasts, her slacks and panties down below her groin. But he was so infuriated by the tension of waiting that he did not stab and mutilate her. Instead, he savagely kicked her head and chest, finally jumping repeatedly on her rib cage. Before leaving, he pushed the body out of sight under the sofa, where it lay undiscovered until March. The disappearance of Yvonne Ann Pearson was reported a day later, but the police were not sure that she had really been killed. Certainly she had left her little daughter Colette in a neighbour's care for the evening only, which argued for it, but on the other hand she was due to appear in court on a soliciting charge in a couple of days, and as this was her third charge, there was every possibility that she might receive a custodial sentence. There would be nothing unusual in a woman with the mercurial and irresponsible temperament of a prostitute jumping bail and disappearing to avoid the risk of prison. 4 days later, the Ripper struck again, not in Leeds or Bradford, however, but Huddersfield. Easily accessible from the Leeds-Bradford conurbation, Huddersfield is a wool town nestling in the Pennines with a far more dramatic setting. There is nothing to suggest that scenic splendour ever played any part in this man's response to life, however. Helen and Rita Ritke were 18-year-old twins. The home of their babyhood was Leopold Street, in the district of Chapeltown. When they were 5, their Italian mother and West Indian father split up, and they were taken into a Catholic hostel in Knaresborough. When they were 15, they read a series on fostering in the Yorkshire Post, and it stimulated them to compose a very effective little poem on loneliness, accompanied by a touching letter saying how much they wished they could be fostered. It won them what should have been a splendid prize. They were very attractive girls, and they were accepted into the happy family of a civil servant in Dewsbury. As they reached the end of their schooling, Rita gained a place in Batley College of Arts and went and stayed in a flat with her adoptive brothers and sisters. Helen got a job in a confectionery family, though she declared that she wanted to make a career as a singer and dancer. It was the first time the twins had been separated, and that may be what went mysteriously wrong. Anyway, Rita suddenly dropped out of art college and disappeared. Helen searched for her, and after 2 months traced her to a squalid bedsit in the worst part of Huddersfield, where she was supporting herself by whoring. Without a moment's hesitation, Helen moved in and joined her. The game in Huddersfield was usually carried on in the Great Northern Street area, using a dismal row of railway arches for knee tremblers. But Helen and Rita were strikingly attractive, with brilliant smiles, and they could afford to restrict themselves to better-off punters with good cars to take them to quiet places. They were reasonably cautious. They always worked together, and as one twin got into a car, the other would take down its number. They allowed a precise 20 minutes per client, and met back outside a men's public lavatory that homosexuals used for cottaging. On the 31st of January, they were slack with the system. They went off at roughly the same time in noted separate cars, but Helen got back 5 minutes before Rita. When a Ford Corsair cruised by, she let the driver persuade her that there would be time for a quickie in a nearby timber yard before her sister got back. When the car stopped in the yard, Helen already had her trousers undone and halfway down her legs, quite prepared to get on with the business, ducking under the glove compartment and steering wheel. The murderer found this unusually exciting, and made the quick excuse that he needed to urinate, a pre-copulatory relief that had put three of his previous victims at his mercy as they crouched in the dark. He got out of the car, but Helen did not follow him. When he came back, she agreed to come into the back seat for the business, and as she stepped out, he swung his hammer at her. But he struck the car a jarring blow with it, and only lightly hit her head. "There's no need for that," cried the terrified girl. "You don't even have to pay." But the killer struck her twice more, before he suddenly realized that two taxi drivers parked at a little distance would see exactly what he was doing if they only looked his way. So he pulled her quickly into the shadows, and proceeded to have intercourse with her, the only one of his victims of whom this was the case. He explained later it was to keep her quiet, an excuse which elicited extreme judicial cynicism when he finally came to trial. Then, when he was satisfied, he pulled up her bra and jumper above her breasts and stabbed her savagely and repeatedly in the chest. He hid the body under a woodpile. Before leaving, he flung her clothes in all directions. Her black lace panties were picked up by a workman the next day and hung mockingly on a nail as evidence of the all kinds of things that went on in the yard at night. Rita did not dare to go to the police to report Helen's disappearance until Friday. When she did so, a police dog very quickly traced the body. In the middle of March, Assistant Chief Constable George Oldfield and the Yorkshire offices of the Daily Mirror both received letters signed Jack the Ripper, purporting to come from the murderer. Oldfield's was curiously friendly, expressing a feeling of closeness to a man who'd called the murderer clever, while the newspapers called him a maniac. The police were disinclined to take the letters seriously. They were posted in Sunderland, which was a long way from Yorkshire. They claimed 8 victims, including the Preston alcoholic prostitute Joan Harrison, and they made no mention of Yvonne Pearson, whose body was discovered in another 2 weeks. Yet there could be doubt whether Yvonne was a real Ripper victim. Her clothes had been dishevelled in his familiar way, but her terrible battering seemed to the pathologist to be the work of a boulder rather than a hammer. Her kicking and trampling was dissimilar from the activities of a man who liked to stab repeatedly in the same wound. The following year, the Jack the Ripper letters would be taken very seriously indeed, and become part of the totally misleading chain of clues with which police and public set their sights on quite the wrong man.